The consummate the refugees back. Okay, so can I get someone to read Genesis 2 and verse 24? Genesis 2 and verse 24.
Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh.
Amen. So the Lord, thank you. So the Lord keeps emphasizing that the two are becoming one flesh. One thing the Lord, and we want a prayer call. I don't offer the prayer call or another Bible study, and Pastor Lisa reminded me that I said this. The Lord told me, you know, we have to be whole human beings going into marriage. So, you know, you hear people say, oh, it's 50-50. No, it's 100%, 100%. And in addition to that, a whole man and a whole woman come together and make up marriage. So we should never try to be halfway anything. We should be all that we can be to the glory of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So, you know, Genesis 2 and 24 talks about leaving the father and mother and holding fast to the wife and the two becoming one flesh. But you have people who marry and then battle that scripture and they put unnecessary strain on their union, right? So many people don't want to hear it. I've heard people say, and maybe you've heard people say this too, you know, men come and go, but family is forever, or women come and go, but family is forever. But what is forever is doing it God's way. God's way is the way that is forever. And here's the thing, cleaving to your spouse does not mean that you do not love your family. It means that obedience is of the utmost importance to you. And when I say obedience, I'm talking about being obedient to the word of God. Okay? And I have to quote Apostle, because I read his book, and forgive me, I don't remember the title off the top of my head, but the words just ring true in my spirit ever since I read it. And it says, the powers of darkness will use that wrong spouse as an agent to further delay God's divine purpose in that child of God's life. When he should be pursuing his destiny, he will be depleting his spiritual ammunition to fight matrimonial battles. So when I heard that, I'm just like, wow. You know what I mean? A lot of times, you know, we take a good idea to the altar, or we take something good looking to the altar, but we need to make sure that what we end up at the altar with, or who we end up at the altar with, is who God designed from the very beginning for us to be linked together with. Or just like the quote from Apostle's book, our destiny will be in jeopardy. Amen.
Amen.
Well, God told me
place are you really listening to, you know? It all depends on your time. How deep are you really in the word, and are you really hearing from the Lord? Or is your flesh, like you, as you said, is your flesh speaking, you know? But yeah, I think it happens a lot in the church, in the body of Christ.
Amen. And like you said, the key is you need to get in the word. The word of God is more important than, you know, the biological clock ticking, or, you know, my eggs, I'm down to my last few eggs, or whatever the reasoning is behind people rushing. I'm telling you, there's a preparation process. And when we do it God's way, you know, he blesses us. The man finds favor, but we'll find favor too in choosing correctly.
Amen.
Did anybody want to add anything to that? I know this is a kind of heavy topic, but I think it's so necessary because, you know, I truly wish that, you know, when I was younger, I had someone to break it down for me like that, so I'll have an understanding, you know, that I'm not just out there just wasting time, is what it ended up being, but, you know, coming together with someone who would further my destiny, or who was designed to be part of the destiny that God had for me.
So, prophetess, when you say choosing, you mean confirming with God, right?
Yes. Yes, okay. Yes, ma'am, yes, confirming. You know, you make the choice, but you allow God to be head of that selection process.
Amen.
Okay,
thank
you. Well, he makes the choice. Amen, amen, yeah. So God makes the choice, and we obey what God is saying, and we go with his choice. Am I clear? I just want to be clear that we're not winging it and we're not doing our own thing, you know, because one of the things is God always gives me analogies, right? So it's like, you know, if God has called you as a man to marry a woman because he has a call on your life to evangelize or preach the gospel, or maybe he wants you to be a missionary, he's not necessarily going to pair you up with someone who has abandonment issues. So the way God does things just makes godly sense, and when we yield to what God is saying to do, we'll get it right. Now, does that mean it's perfect? No, because we still have our own free will, and, you know, we can choose to obey God's word, or we can choose to just do our own thing. way that we communicate with the opposite sex, right? It can even after you get married. I know people who, and I had a woman recently, who recently got married. She might have been married 2 months, and there are already problems because there are things that she should have handled and he should have handled before they came together in marriage, so that it didn't hinder what the Lord was bringing together. So, you know, communication. When I say that, I'm saying,
right time, right, of the day? I was saying communicating at the right time of the day, right?
Oh, well, yeah. I mean, but see, I guess you have to understand and learn your partner, because one of the things we did after we got married, we would go to bed, we would pray, we would sit up spending time talking. So for us, the evening was ideal, but then as we got further along in the marriage, you know, I guess different times of day work better now. Yeah, we should be able to communicate any time, but, you know, he teleworks, he works from home, so it's like, you know, he's doing his business stuff, you know, that's not the time. So, yeah, like you said, the right time, you know, and you'll know based on communication.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, but depending upon what it is, if it's something important, especially regarding you two, especially if it's regarding the relationship, even if you're in a marriage and it has to do with finances, it has to do with the house. Mm-hmm. If there's something that's bothering you, please don't hold on to it. Communicate that with your partner.
Yeah.
Every time that you communicate, to me, it brings me closer to her. You know, communication just opens up that door that it makes you want to hold on to them and not let them go.
Amen. Amen. So the first point was communication. The second is serving one another. Serving one another. We talked about submission last week, or someone asked about submission, because, you know, the emphasis seems to be put on the fact that the woman is supposed to submit, and that is scripture. But, you know, when you read Ephesians 5, and you can just jot this down and read it later, Ephesians 5, verses 22 to 33, it starts out, verse 22, saying, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord, right? And normally when I teach that or say that, the question from women is, well, what do men have to do if we have to submit, right? Verse 25 tells us that. It tells us, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. So God knows what he's doing. He knows, you know, how to balance it as the man being the head and the covering and the woman being the one who submits. But if your man, or your husband rather, is loving you the way that Christ loved the church, then you're not going to feel, you know, any kind of way negatively about submitting, because you know you're submitting to someone who is submitting to the Lord.
Amen.
And most of the submission comes from the husband anyway in a relationship. We submit everything to our wives, so all the time.
Amen. Amen. But yeah, serving one another, right? Mutual submission, right? Ephesians 5 and 21 commands us to submit to one another out of reverence to Christ. So like I said before, marriage is 50-50, it's 100-100, each willing to surrender all to the other person, right? That means no secrets, no lies, no harboring resentment, no retaliation, none of that stuff that can divide people, right? So when we talk about serving, you know, sometimes we can get lax in our roles. And even earlier this week, I was watching something on TV. I don't know if it was part of a news segment or something, but with the whole quarantine thing, there was a mom who, I guess she was trying to teach her daughters a lesson, right? So she had a piece of paper, and she put a $5 bill on the back of the paper, and she put it on the floor in the bathroom. She watched how many times that day the daughters were just back and forth in the bathroom and stepped over the piece of paper. So she had to sit them down and tell them, look, if you would have picked up the paper, you would have gotten this $5 that was at the back of the paper. And I say that to say that, you know, in marriage, you know, we have these strict roles, right? Like women cook, or maybe the man cooks, or the man takes out the garbage, the man fixes stuff, but we should always be able to lend a when you submit to each other and you serve each other, God is pleased. That's something that, you know, fortifies your marriage as well.
Can I
if you guys don't mind?
Yes.
My name is Mark. Sorry, guys. Sorry for interrupting. My name is Mark. I'm a newcomer to the call.
Hi, Mark.
Hi, everybody. Grace and peace. I just asked you to give me a call. It's actually really nice knowing you guys. I want to add a little to that in the sense that once you it's like you have to take out
I was saying that in the part of the submission process, humbling yourself is a big part, like actually removing pride. Because what leads to a downfall in a marriage is pride at times, because either the husband thinks he's more superior than the wife, or the wife thinks, oh, it's not fair that I should submit to you, or stuff like that, you know, and then there's like a whole confusion, and this is what the devil delights in. But when the wife submits to the husband, it's not submitting in the sense that you are more superior than me. It's more so submitting so like you guys can work together as a team, because marriage is a team thing. Marriage is not where exactly it's not where the man should do this. The man should go to work, provide for the family. Don't get me wrong, he should definitely do that, right? And it shouldn't be like, oh, the woman should stay home and cook and take care of the kids. No. It should go both ways, you know? And basically, to add on to your point, how you said that, I think you said submission will like kind of like unify the whole entire family or so, and God delights in that. I definitely agree with that, and I couldn't agree more, because like I said, I was saying, like, submission is really, it's a key point in a marriage, and it also, it's like teamwork, you know? God likes when the whole family's unified, you know? And like I said, Now generations, like, people are just like struggling with the submission process, because people are not able to humble themselves. People think of submission as in, okay, I am more superior than you. You shouldn't have that mindset. You shouldn't think like that. You know, when I was very little, I used to think of that particular scripture. Like, wait, this is not really fair. Then, like, how is it that the woman is submitting to the man? It shouldn't really go both ways. But I actually understand as I started to grow up and my mindset started to change, I started to understand it's not submission in the sense that one is superior than the other, but it's submission in the sense that it's a team thing, but it's also submission to align yourself with God. Align yourself. You know? Okay. Amen. Amen. Yes.
Okay.
And now, once again, I was going to say, Chica introduced me to the line. Thank you, Chica. Thank God for this. I love this prayer call, and I'm definitely going to commit myself to be on this every Thursday. I'm so glad to be here, by the way. So glad to be here. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. That's good. Did anyone else want to add something on to that? Amen. So we're talking about serving and being submissive. And another thing that we need to do in marriage for it to be healthy, we must live 1 Corinthians 13. Well, we have to live the whole word, but what 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 8 says. So it talks about what love is, right? That love is patient, love is kind, it doesn't envy. Write it down. You can read the whole thing. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. So we have to get that, you know. And the thing is, and I think someone just shared that at the beginning of the call, you know, because of our past, there's things that may make us feel like, well, I don't have to always be kind, or I'm going to keep records of wrongs. Remember the last time you did this, that, or the other thing. But when we transform our lives and line up to what the Word says, then marriage can be what God to do it God's way. Period.
Amen.
Period.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. That's good. Okay. Any questions with that? Well, I think 1 Corinthians 13 is pretty clear. Let me just talk a little bit about not putting any earthly relationship before your marriage. We're not talking about God here because He is always first. He is always foremost, right? But the phrase, the part of the scripture that it says, let no man put asunder, is not just a good, you know, King James Version wedding line, right? It's God's desire for a marriage. So great couples or people who want to have a thriving, healthy marriage should strive to allow no one, even children, even in-laws, to get in the way of building a healthy marriage. Now, a lot of people feel some kind of way about that, right? So I know women who have gotten divorced because they say, oh, well, he put his mother first, and, you know, he didn't do the whole leave and cleave thing. And there are men who have divorced because, oh, she put her children before me. God desires for us to do it His way, right? Children will grow up one day and leave, but our goal in marriage should be to live a legacy where we are modeling healthy marriage, not just for our children, but for people who may see us every day, or people, you know, we work with, or our neighbor, or whoever it may be. I remember, you know, my husband and I, well, we still do it, we walk, and we go to the store, we're always holding hands, and there was always someone stopping us saying, you can tell that you two really love each other, you know, because we're holding hands, because we're happy and pleased to be in each other's company. And other people see that, and it encourages them. Because, you know, marriage has gotten a bad rap because of people who, like the brother said, they come into the relationship with this pride and have already made up their mind, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that, and they don't yield, they don't submit, they don't give all that they should give according to the word. Amen?
Amen.
So nothing should come except God. Nothing should come before, you know, your union, your marriage. We have to safeguard that. We have to, like I said, let that be our legacy. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Any questions, comments, concerns?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
My question is, what if you're in a marriage that... sorry, can you guys hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. What if you're in a marriage where one spouse is willing to submit in any way, in any means necessary, but the other spouse is not? And what would you do in that case? And you're really trying your best to submit, but the other spouse just can't understand the grasp of concept. So what could you really do at that moment? Yes, I understand. Definitely put God first, hands down. But you should always pray over it. I understand that. But what else can you do? What else can you do that's more effective in any way, in any case?
Therapy.
Someone said therapy, but my take would also be, you know, by submitting, the one who is submitting is in fact modeling what submission is. And sometimes people only get it or will get it eventually by consistently seeing it. So, I mean, if the wife is the one
I just want to say just one thing.
Yeah, I just
want to say, I was just very passionate about it. I wasn't angry at me. I'm not even married yet. So young, you know. So funny, y'all. Just like learning, you know. So I can use this in my marriage.
Well, it's a good thing for you to know so that when God brings the person, but you already sound like you have a relationship with God, so you won't be caught in that. That's why
right.
You're doing this now. It's so important. There's so many people that are in relationships now that they weren't supposed to be in, whether it was because someone got pregnant and, as they say, it was a shotgun wedding or whatever the situation is. We messed up sometimes. I've messed up before because I chose to be in a relationship that God didn't assign me to be. We said last week, I'm going to hear a testimony. We said last week, what did we say last week? We just lost it. We were talking last week, and one of the things I said was, I don't know if this may not supposed to come out, is why I'm not being able to get it. I'm going to share it anyway. Oh, yeah. About not marrying an assignment. Not sometimes we as men, and especially women, too, we want to help people in things, right? And when we help people, sometimes we become involved with that person, and you're thinking that you're supposed to marry that person. I remember working in New York, and I met this young lady. And at the time, I think I wasn't going to church. And when I met her, she was talking about a church. And the church she was talking about happened to be the church where my family go to. Anyway, one thing led to another, and she came. We got involved in a relationship, and things happened. And I was with her, and I had to stay with her to protect her from her ex. And it was, again, not supposed to be a relationship that I wasn't supposed to be in, and we wind up becoming married. Now, I was blessed to have a beautiful daughter from her, and but it didn't work out. Again, another situation, the same thing, because you're working with somebody, as you 10-hour days and stuff, and you become involved in a relationship. Yes. Some people say these are my work wives or my work husbands. Ooh, don't never let my wife currently now and nobody say that. We rebuke that in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We get so caught up in relationships that, you know, things happen and things. But if it's not the one that God assigned us to do, it's not going to work. Enjoying it in the moment and things, but if it's not assigned by God, but then after that, I said, God, I don't want to be married no more. And I was by myself in South Jersey, and I felt like now God was laughing at me because I didn't know what He had set aside for me. And we connected with my current wife. That's when we started talking on the telephone. That's when she was praying with me. When I didn't want to pray anymore, I said, God, I don't want to hurt nobody no more, and I don't want nobody to hurt me. I'll be single for the rest of my life. And he was like, dude, you just don't know what I got for you.
Amen.
So this is so important so we don't make those mistakes. Those are detours. Those are things that the enemy tries to keep. If I wasn't married, Pastor Linda, I wouldn't be a pastor right now. I'm a single dude, being in a church and warming a bench maybe somewhere. I wouldn't have the kind of relationship I have right now. I wouldn't be in the poor like I have now. Neither the other relationship
Amen.
It ain't about finances or anything else. I want a praying wife over anything else.
Jesus.
So God,
amen.
Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Look at what God has surrounded you guys
my
with.
God, my God.
And talk to those people. Let them be your mentor. Learn and watch them.
Hallelujah. That's right.
Amen. 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 Dr. Collins kept saying praying together, and that was the next point because it's so critical. I know people who, you know, I'm always getting calls. I'm always getting messages. I'm always getting texts. And people are having issues in their marriage. And a lot of times I find out that they don't even pray together. It's great for us to pray because we have to have that one-on-one with God. But you should be able to come together with your spouse to pray.
There's nothing more beautiful than when you pray.
Yeah, when you're praying, there is the power of agreement that's in effect, right? So Matthew 18 and verse 19 says, again I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. So, I mean, that could be two believers, that could be two sisters in Christ praying for something, but when you have a spouse and you pray together, that's built in agreement. Under the roof and under your household. You should be praying together for financial breakthroughs, right? For employment breakthroughs, for breakthroughs in your health. There's power in agreement, and that is a powerful tool in marriage that a lot don't use. I don't know why, but they should be using, right? Scripture says one can chase a thousand and two can put 10,000 to flight. So if the two of you coming together praying, you're going to put to flight anything that's trying to come up against your household. Amen?
Amen.
God is good. Did anyone have any questions? I wanted to close out in prayer and answer the questions if there are any. I really would like someone to pray for those who are seeking marriage. I need someone to pray for those who are currently dating, and then someone to just pray for the married couples that are either on the line or might hear this after the fact. But if we have any questions, we'll take those first. Amen.
I actually wanted to say something. I'm a single parent, and I have an adult son. And so we want to live, you know, he's an adult man who really hasn't had a previous relationship. And, of course, as a woman, a single woman on the line, it's really difficult for us to kind of help an adult male that is kind of struggling in that area. So we ended up, like, watching a video together, and the man of God was saying that single men should find a wife, and men should never enter into relationships with women without planning to marry. But do you agree with that?
Yeah, because that's what courting is. God's design for marriage is, you know, it was never created to be a buffet. So let me go out there, let me sow my wild oats, let me see what this one is like or that one is like. It should really be to get to know someone in the hope that it should lead to marriage. Now, I'm not saying that the first person he dates, oh, he has to marry her, but you should always do that seeking with marriage in mind. Because dating is not, you know, dating is just a worldly construct, and we're not doing things the way the world does. And the word, again, remember at the beginning, I learned the scripture. You know, the man who finds a wife finds a good thing, and he obtains favor. So he wants that favor as well. So, I would say definitely. And if that means for him, though, that he needs to sit back and watch a woman, pray about that woman, and hear what God is saying about that woman, I would tell him and instruct him to do that before, you know, taking any steps. Because like I said last week, a lot of times like Pastor Cal said, if they're walled up, and if they're walled up, that has to either be dealt with, or maybe that's not the relationship for him.
Yes, absolutely. I grew up without my father, and the same thing. My mother raised four sons by herself. And my mother gave us a book, I think, and stuff to read about, you know, the birds and the bees and stuff, and then asked if we have any questions. I mean, you're not going to ask your mom questions about that being a man and things. But I think right now one of the best ways to do it is, I just mentioned those men in your ministry, in your church and things. We're watching. I always watch and learn from people, and that's how you know, and that's how you stay connected. If he can be there in the church, and he can watch a pastor be, he can watch a Pastor Seattle, he can watch Apostle I.D., especially the way they are with their families and their wives.
Yeah.
I mean, for the love that they have and they share with the ministry, it's the same thing that they share with their families and things. Those are the kind of people that we should look for and want our sons to learn from. I didn't speak that back then as a younger man. Back then in the streets of the South Bronx, I was running the streets, doing things, and learning the hard way and things. But now, after seeing this great ministry we all are part of and things, that's what I would do if I was a single woman. And even I was in a lot of Boy Scouts and things, but you have to be careful with that. If it's not like coming from a church base, you know, let God lead you. And even with your job, Pastor Lisa, my job, we have an Explorer program with U.S. Customs and Border Protection. Here's the police department, the detective. I know you don't want all of them cops to put any values into your stuff. We know the way to things, but you find them and let God feed you and show you in that.
Yeah, and that's what I was trying to encourage them. You have to be a part of a great fellowship of like-minded believers in order for you to really grow in that area, because if you're not connected in that manner, it's not going to help you, you know?
Yeah.
But thank you. Thank you.
Amen.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Hi, everyone. By the way, amazing job as always. This has been very informative. The question I have is for the young men and women in the church who are waiting on God and preparing themselves for marriage, what advice do you have for them as they wait on how to prepare themselves? Because 1 Timothy 5, verse 14 says, I will therefore that the younger woman marry, bear children, guide the house, give no occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully. Because quite often you meet people in the church, they are praying about marriage, they are fasting about it, but they're not really preparing themselves, you know, for what is to come after marriage, you know, and how for the young men, you know, after marriage, you have to be responsible for a lot of things in the marriage, you know. How do you advise them, the women and the men, to prepare themselves financially, psychologically, even physically and mentally as well, too, as they wait to also take the time to prepare themselves to also get ready for what is to come after the marriage? That's it.
That's Pastor Seattle.
Yes, sir.
Amen. God bless you. Pastor, what I would say is that we put so much emphasis on marriage and relationship, it almost becomes a sin. God said, thou shalt have no other gods
Thank you.